Hello, my dear students. This is Aritra Chakraborty. Today, I am going to discuss about circuit interruption device. Today is the first part of my presentation. So, the first slide is the introduction. So, what is switchgear? Switchgear can be defined as a basic way that is combination of switching device and controlling device, which is associated to current interruption devices, including control circuit, measuring instrument, metering, regulation, and other associated equipments of electrical power system. That means switchgear is a branch of instrument or branch of electrical devices. It consists of some combination of switching device, that means the current interruption devices. Number two, the controlling circuit or controlling device and measuring instrument. So, at first, the current interruption device. The current interruption device in switchgear are the switches, fuses, circuit breaker, isolator, and the control device which control the mechanism of current interruption device. These are relays, current and potential transformer, indicating instrument, and control panel, etc. In the situation of heavy current load or any fault in the electrical power system, the equipment tends to get damaged by the help of short circuit current or overload current, or you can say overcurrent. The equipment tends to get damaged and service is also interrupted. In order to protect the electrical equipments from any possible damage, these switchgear protection devices are required. So there are two types of fault mainly. One is over voltage fault and one is over current fault. And this fault are cleared by this current interruption devices. And mainly the over current faults is cleared by the current interruption devices. And the over voltage fault is cleared by the lightning arrestor. It is one type of switchgear which is used to protect the devices from lightning. So switchgear devices provide a way in which power equipment can be re-energized and faults can be cleared. Now the next slide is the basic terminology of fuse, or some basic property or some basic terms related to the fuse. Number one, what is fuse? Fuse is a protecting device which is used to protect the electrical devices, electrical circuit, electrical equipments from overcurrent. A fuse is a short piece of metal inserted in the circuit which melts when excessive current flow through it and thus break the circuit. That means fuse has a low conductivity and high resistance. Okay. Now, fuse element. The most commonly used material for fuse element are lead, tin, copper or lead tin alloy, zinc and silver. Silver is a special type of fuse. It is known as HRC fuse. The next one is rated current. So what is the rated current? It is the current which the fuse element can normally carry without overheating or melting. That means the current which can flow through a fuse without melting it or without damaging it. So the normal rated current of fuse is the rated current. Fusing current. It is the minimum current at which the fuse element melts and thus disconnects the circuit protected by it. So this is the melting current, at which current the fuse elements melt, or the short circuit current, or the maximum current at which the fuse melt and protect the devices. Fusing factor. It is the ratio of maximum fusing current to the current rating of the fuse element. So maximum fusing current means in which current fuse gets melt, and the current rating of the fuse element means the normal rated current, or in which current the fuse can operate in the circuit, or in which current the fuse doesn't melt. So fusing factor equals to minimum fusing current by current rating of the fuse. So minimum fusing current means the minimum current at which the fuse gets melt. Now the prospective current, it is the RMS value of the first loop of the fault current obtained if the fuse is replaced by an ordinary conductor of negligible resistance. It is the RMS value. RMS value means the root mean square value. What is root mean square value? It is the DC value, or you can say the value of current, the active value of current which produced heat in the circuit. That is the RMS value of the first loop of the fault current. That means the first cycle of the fault current obtained if the fuse is replaced by an ordinary conductor of negligible resistance. If we replace the fuse by a low resistance conductor or low resistive conductor, then the RMS value of the first loop of the fault current, that means the first cycle of the fault current, the root mean square value of the first cycle of the fault current is known as the prospective current. Cutoff current, it is the maximum value of fault current actually reached before the fuse melt. So before melting of fuse, the maximum value of the current, that means after the cutoff current, if the current is increased, then cutoff current, then the fuse gets melt. Pre-arcing time, it is the time between the commencement of fault and the instant when cutoff occurs. So there is a very small time span is known as pre-arcing time. That is, it is the time between the commencement of fault, when the fault is occur, and the instant when the fuse melts. So this, between these two instant, there is a small time. This is the pre-arcing time. Arcing time, this is the time when the end of pre-arcing time and the instant when the arc is extinguished. Arc means when the fuse melts, then there is an air gap is produced, and due to the high electric stress, the ionized particle in the air gap is carrying the current. That means the air, the atom of the air, by the help of electric stress, it converted into atom, converted into ion, then the current is flowing through the air, and after that air is a highly resistive medium. So when current is flowing through the air, then there is a heat produced, enormous heat produced, and this heat energy is converted into electrical energy. This is known as arc. So arcing time means this is the time between the end of pre-arcing time and the instant when arc is extinguished. So pre-arcing time and when the arc is totally removed or extinguished, between these two time, the span is called the arcing time. That means in which time the arc is persist, the flash is persist. Okay. Total operating time, it is the sum of pre-arcing and arcing time. Rupturing capacity, it is the RMS value of AC component of maximum prospective current that a fuse can deal with at rated service voltage. So it is the root mean square value of AC component. That means the AC value of the RMS value. Okay, RMS value, that means IRMS equals to IDC value. IRMS equals to IDC value. So the AC component, that means the alternating component of maximum prospective current that a fuse can deal with a rated service voltage, that is the rupturing capacity. Now, the time versus current curve of a fuse. So you can see here in x-axis there is time and in y-axis the current. And if fault occurs, then the asymmetrical current is flowing through the path or through the circuit. So this is a graph of asymmetrical current, and A point is the cutoff current, that means after that the fuse will get melt, and at current zero, that means when the arc is finished or arc is extinguished, that means at the point of zero or current zero, and the origin, at the origin of the graph the fault is occurs, and from the fault to the cutoff current is the pre-arcing time, and from the cutoff current to the arc extinguished period is the arcing time equals to the total operating time. Next, the characteristics of a fuse. Number one, low melting point. That means in very low temperature fuse can be melt. So its melting point is low. If it has a high melting point, then it can't protect the electrical devices, because if the short circuit current or overload current is persist for too much time in a circuit, then the apparatus, electrical apparatus which are connected in the circuit, gets damaged. So fuse must have a low melting point. In a small heat it will melt. High conductivity, free from deterioration due to oxidation, low cost. So these are mainly the fuse characteristics. Now, special type of fuse, that is high rupturing capacity fuse. This is HRC fuse. So HRC fuse consists of heat resisting ceramic body having metal end caps on which silver current carrying element is welded in a special manner. This fuse is used in medium voltage range, that means above 400 volt to 650 volt. It is used in medium voltage, it's HRC fuse. In case of motor, mainly HRC fuse is used. So the fuse element have a portion of tin alloy known as eutectic material. This alloy is used to give the fuse specific operating characteristics. Also, constriction in the fuse element are provided, which play a very vital role in the operation of fuse. The space between the bodies surrounding the fuse element is filled of filling powder such as silica and chalk, plaster of Paris, etc. Not only the tin alloy but also the silver is also used in case of HRC fuse, and the filling powder like chalk, silica sand, these are used as a arc quenching medium, or it can absorb the heat. When the fuse gate melts or the fuse is heated, then these mediums absorb the heat. You can see here an image of HRC fuse. It can be also, you can see HRC cartridge fuse. The outer part it name known as the brass end cap, and in the inner part filling powder, bimetallic thermal control, fuse element that is made by the silver, fuse link contacts, outer elements and the cartridge. So these are the various parts of HRC fuse. So now the working principle of HRC fuse. So under normal operating condition, the current flowing through the fuse element does not provide enough energy to melt the element. The heat produced in the is absorbed by the surrounding filling powder. If a large current flows, the energy produced melts and vaporizes the fuse element before the fault current reaches the peak. The chemical reaction between the fuse element, vapors and filling powder results into high resistance material which helps in extinguish the arc. As I have already said, so this is the working principle of HRC fuse. Now the advantages. The HRC fuse is able to clear heavy fault safety, so it is used for medium voltage protection or overload protection of motor. Low temperature rise at full load. They do not require maintenance because there is also a heat absorbing medium is produced. It protects the large industrial load. And disadvantages, it is more expensive than rewearable or cartridge fuse because it cannot be rewearable. You have to replace that after one operation. Most uneconomical, as the whole unit will have to be replaced after blowing the fuse wire. So these are the disadvantages. Now the next circuit interruption device is isolator. So isolator means the isolation switch which isolates the healthy electrical part or healthy electrical line from the faulty line. So isolator are disconnecting switches which can be used to disconnect a circuit under no load condition. It is used in no load condition. You can't use it in full load or on load condition. They are generally used along with the circuit breaker. An isolator can be opened only after the circuit breaker. They are mainly two types. So after operating of circuit breaker, you have to use or you have to operate the isolator. That means the circuit breaker is operating in on load condition and isolator is operating in off load condition. So at first the single pole isolator, three pole isolator and earth switch or earth isolator. Single pole isolator means it is used in single phase system, and three pole isolator means there are three contacts, that means it is used in three phase three well line. And earth switch and earth isolator, earth switch is connected between the line conductor and the earth. Normally it is open. When the line is disconnected, the earth switch is closed so as to discharge the voltage trapped on the line. Normally earth switch is mounted on the frame of the isolator. So normally it is in open condition. When the fault occurred, when the main isolator is disconnected from the line, then we have to close the earth isolator to discharge the fault current or the trapped voltage on the line. Okay, so now these are the images of isolator. These are the three pole isolators. So types of isolator, so it can be classified into three categories: double break type isolator, single break type isolator and pantograph type isolator. So number one, double brick type isolator. This type of isolator consists of three loads of post insulators. The middle insulator holds a flat mail or tubular contact that can be turned straightly by a spin of middle post insulator. The rotation of middle post insulator can be done by a lever method at the bottom of the post insulator, as well as it is related to manual operation or motorized operation of the isolator via a mechanical knot rod. So there are two contacts, and the middle portion of the isolator can be moved anywhere, and the movement is done by mechanically or by motor via a lever or a mechanical knot rod. So this is the double brick type isolator. Now single brick type isolator. In this type of isolator, the arm contact is separated into two elements. The first arm contacts hold male contact, as well as the second arm contact holds the female contact. The arm contact shift because of the post insulator rotation upon which the arm contact are fixed. That means there are two parts which are separated into two elements. First contact is with the male contact connected, and second contact is connected with the female contact. So this is the single brick type isolator. Now the post insulator rotation stacks in reverse to each other, which makes to shut the isolator by shutting the arm contact, and the post insulator counter rotation stacks to open the arm contact, as well as an isolator rotated into on off condition. Generally, the motor operated isolator is used. However, an emergency manual operated isolator is also offered. So, in case of emergency situation, the manually operated isolator is used. Now, the pantograph type isolator. The pantograph type isolator permits current switchgear installation and is required least space. This type of insulator includes a post insulator as well as an operating insulator. So what is pantograph? Pantograph is a special type of construction which is used to collect current in electric traction. So this isolator is like a pantograph. So this is known as pantograph type isolator. According to the power system location, the isolator can be classified. So it is used in different types of area of power system location. These are three types mainly: one bus side, line side, and transfer bus side. So power system location based isolators, that is the pantograph isolator, mainly pantograph isolator, or you can use any type of isolator here. These are bus side isolator, line side isolator, and transfer bus side isolator. Number one, the bus side isolator is a type of isolator that connects by the major bus. Major bus means from where the transmission line, the power is fed to the transmission line or the distribution line, bus bar, from where that line is distributed. This is the major bus. Number two, the line side isolator stay connected by a feeder in line side. So stay connected by a feeder, that means the transmission line. It is connected in the transmission line. And transfer bus side. So transfer bus means when the major bus is not operating, then another bus is connected in the power system. This is the transfer bus. So transfer bus side isolator stay connected by the major bus of a transformer, and it is connected with the transformer, this transfer bus. Now the sequence of operation of isolator. While an isolator in opening condition, at first you have to open the circuit breaker, then you have to open the isolator and closed the earth isolator or earth switch in case of maintenance or in case of fault. And while closing, after maintenance or after clearing the fault, ensure circuit breaker is open at first, then open the earth switch, then close the isolator. That means you have to ensure that at first the circuit breaker is open. That means there is no load condition. That means there is no current is flowing through the line. So circuit breaker is open. After that, you have to open the earth switch in normal operating condition. Then close the isolator and close the circuit breaker. So these are the sequence of opening and closing of an isolator. Now, the next slide is auto decloser. It is also a current interruption device. In electric power distribution, a decloser or auto decloser is a circuit breaker that can automatically close after it has been opened due to a fault. So, this is a circuit breaker that can automatically close after it has been opened due to a fault. Reclosers are used on overhead distribution system to detect the interrupt momentary faults since many short circuit on overhead lines clear. That means it is also a circuit breaker that can automatically close after it has been opened due to a fault. When a fault occur, it is open, and when the fault is cleared, then it is automatically closed. So decloser are used in an overhead distribution system to detect and interrupt the momentary fault. If there is a momentary fault occurs, it interrupt and clear the fault. After clearing the fault, it will automatically reclose. So this is the auto decloser. That's all for today. Thank you.